Reduce, reuse, recycle, we've been told, to manage plastic waste. If only we're all good kids, so the story, plastic would cease being a problem. But in a sequel that'll sound all too familiar, it turns out that the plastic industry promoted this recycling myth for decades while knowing that it wouldn't work, as a recent report from the Center of Climate Integrity reveals. In the 1990s, companies including Exxon, Chevron, Dow and DuPont financed clean-looking and optimistic recycling adverts, while internal reports reveal that they admitted their recycling goals were a stretch. That's what the Center for Climate Integrity says in any case. But who are they? They're an US-American nonprofit which wants the fossil fuel industry to pay for the damages they have done to the environment and us. So you kind of knew what they'd conclude before they even wrote the report, didn't you? Let's have a look. The world produces about 450 million tons of plastic per year. That's enough to fill 45 million recycling trucks. Currently, we recycle less than 10% of that. And it's not like the problem is getting smaller. According to the OECD, plastic use has doubled globally from the year 2000 to 2019. They project that by 2060, we'll have three times more plastic than today. And if nothing changes, three times more plastic waste. The fraction of plastic waste that's recycled basically hasn't changed for the past decade. The major reason that plastic isn't recycled more often is that doing it well is expensive and makes no financial sense. There are many different types of plastic, and if you melt them together, the quality of the material degrades quickly. Even if you have the same sort of plastic, it might contain different additives, and dealing with them all is a chemist's nightmare, which is quite something if you consider that for ordinary people, chemistry is a nightmare already. That plastic is difficult to recycle is hardly a new insight. In 1969, at the First National Conference on Packaging Waste in San Diego, one of the attending scientists said very clearly, the very success of package makers in marrying dissimilar materials has made packaging materials virtually unrecoverable after use. He also said that the waste should be cleaned up by those who generate it, and that's, quote, the consumer, not the producer. So the science was pretty clear ever since they started mass producing plastic. And as the report from the Center for Climate Integrity says, the plastic industry was well aware that recycling for the most part just wouldn't work, though of course that was partly due to the way they produced it in the first place. Which is why in the 1970s, the plastic industry advocated incineration, also known as waste to energy. But burning plastic is a messy, dirty and smelly business. People didn't like it. They pushed the industry to get better at recycling. And so what did the plastic industry do? Well, they promised better recycling despite knowing that this wasn't possible to the extent they were told to do it. Now I ask you, who's to blame? The producer who knew that recycling wouldn't work and said we better burn it? Or the consumer who said we don't care that it doesn't work, please pretend it'll work so that we can feel better about ourselves? Let me be clear that I'm not saying we shouldn't recycle. Of course, we should reduce, reuse and recycle as much plastic as possible. And we should also push producers to produce with the goal of recycling in mind. The question is, what do we do with the rest? The stuff that we want to first use, then throw away, but that despite best efforts isn't fit for recycling. Producing a new piece of plastic takes more energy than recycling it. The major reason is that the production of the plastic molecules itself eats up energy. That raises the question of how much energy do you get back when you burn the stuff? The brief answer is that it depends a lot on factors like how far the waste had to be transported and how well it's sorted and how good the burning facility is. But while plastic is made from fossil fuels and generally burns well, it contains other stuff too, and that makes the burning dirty and inefficient. It also releases greenhouse gases and leaves behind toxic residues. All that makes burning an unappealing option. Then again, while most studies have found that recycling plastic is energetically preferable to burning it, they also more or less agree that putting plastic into landfill is the worst possible option. Sabine. The UN strategy for dealing with plastic waste banks on more sophisticated recycling technologies, alternatives to plastic and controlled landfills. They call that reduce, reuse, recycle, and reorient and diversify. And that's probably the best idea in principle. But will it work in practice? It's all well and fine that chemists are working on turning plastic into fuel, and I'm sure this will work eventually. But what do we do until then? Are we not making the same mistake again as we did in the 1970s, that we're asking producers to do the impossible, and then in 20 years some integrity organization will blame companies for not doing what wasn't possible in the first place? We better find a realistic solution sooner rather than later. The Ellen MacArthur Foundation estimates that we have about 150 million metric tons of plastic in the ocean, more than 250,000 of those floating on the surface, trapping birds and fish. About 90% of seabirds now have plastic in their guts. All that plastic eventually grinds down to microscopic particles, the so-called microplastics, that are now contaminating the entire food chain and that have been linked to various detrimental health effects. And recent research out of Scotland, somewhat ironically, found that the chopping, shredding and washing of old plastics for recycling creates a lot of microplastics which get into the air and surrounding environment. When I look at those numbers, it seems to me that at least for now, the question comes down to whether to burn it or eat it. And if I look at it that way, maybe burning the stuff isn't such a bad idea. It can be difficult to make sense of the news you find online, but I found Ground News to be a great time saver. Ground News is a news platform that provides you with a lot of extra information that you don't find in the standard media. Take, for example, this recent story about how the Arctic Sea might be ice-free by 2030. Ground News will tell you the talking points of the different political orientations, and you can see right away that this story basically hasn't been covered by the right. You also get a factuality rating for each news item, and it tells you whom the media outlets are owned by. Isn't this amazing to have all this information so readily available? Ground News currently has a special page for the upcoming US elections. It's super useful to get the context that you need to make sense of the headlines. It's also really interesting to see how much the coverage differs between the left and the right. Ground News is supported by its subscribers and offers plans for as little as $1 per month to keep it widely accessible. I support Ground News because I think it's a simple yet effective way to be well informed, and I recommend you head over to give it a try yourself. And of course, I have a special offer. If you use my link ground.news/Sabine, you'll get 40% off their unlimited access Vantage plan for less than $5 a month. So go and give it a try. I'm sure you'll find it useful. Thanks for watching. See you tomorrow.